wrap up this time of worship with just a quick word of prayer. Lord, we praise you and we thank you because of how good you are to us. Lord, we trust you. We know that you are so much more confident, wise than we are. So Lord, we submit our ways to you. We know that your thoughts are far above ours. So we submit our bodies, we submit our thoughts, our opinions to your will. Lord, would you lead us? Would your Holy Spirit speak to us? God, we know that you can do so much more with our time, our energy, our resources than we could ever imagine to do without you. So Lord, would you lead us? Would you guide us? We praise you and we thank you in your name, amen. Throughout scripture, God takes the treatment of his children vitally important. That's why at GV Christian Center, we do the same. Our private school, Green Valley Christian School, serves our community by ministering to students, not only academically, but also spiritually, in excellence and in leadership. So our staff is committed to the same. They care about not only the academics, but also the spiritual health of our students. We're currently hiring for our staff. So if you have a passion, you have a desire and a love for investing into the next generation of students to see them be the next leaders, not only academically, but also spiritually in our community, we would love for you to apply. You can scan the QR code on the back of the chair in front of you or on the screen that you're watching for more information. I also want to encourage you to mark your calendars for May 21st so that you can join us for our annual vision, information, and prayer meeting. Not too long ago, we collected jars full of change for Convoy of Hope's Women Empowerment, where they are empowering women all around the world, investing into them and their future, setting them up with small businesses so that they can continue to succeed for generations to come, giving them and their children an opportunity of a lifetime. So we donated all of that to Convoy of Hope, and we just wanted to let you know, church, just how much of a generous church you are, because just recently we donated a check of $6,000 that is going to women all around the world. So thank you, church, for your generosity, for your giving, because it makes an impact all around the world in lives of women and their children everywhere. But today, God has a word for you. He's ready to speak to you in your heart and make a difference in your home right where you are. So let's tune in. Let's see what God has in store for us today.
Oh, welcome everyone to GV Christian Online. I am so glad that you've joined us. And this week we continue this series, Give, Save, and Live. Give, Save, Live. We're going to get into that in just a little bit. But moms, I want to thank you for your prayers. And so you might be listening to this on whatever date, but it just happens to be that this is Mother's Day weekend. And the prayers of a mom, you know what? The prayers of a mom touch the heart of God. I believe that like no other kind of prayer. There's something about just the prayers of a mom. And today we're going to see a mom recorded in God's word for all of eternity, a widow who lived in a desperate time in her life. And maybe some of you are in desperate times. Maybe a widow or not a widow. Maybe married, maybe single, maybe divorced, whatever heartbrokenness you or desperate time you find yourself in. This woman was going through a tough time. In her case, as we're about to read, there was no food. No food. I've never been without any food, not where I could somehow get it. I got really hungry, you know, skip a few meals, but there was no food. It was a drought, middle of the drought, agricultural. There's no water. There's no food. Water was just about gone. She has a son to take care of at home. And in addition, there are other people, we don't know how many, but there were other people in the household. And there was nothing for her to really, as a mom, just feed her son. She was preparing for her and her son to starve to death. How sad is that? That's desperation. But the most amazing thing happened. We're going to read about it again. But she was presented with a choice in her greatest time of need. And one of the most profound true stories of faith and trust in the Bible, we see from this mom. You excited to read it? You should be. The prayers of a mom are so powerful. It's not unusual in the mornings. Meg will tell me how often she was awake the night before because she was praying for our kids or for our grandkids or for a need in your life or the life of somebody around you. Meg and I raised three kids, and at times we disagreed and even argued over different things, but we made some decisions a long time ago that turned out at the time to be seem so small, but they turned out to be big decisions. We decided, because of what Jesus said, to get onto the same page financially and to leave a legacy for our three kids and to leave a legacy for the kingdom of God. And we, very simply, we just don't fight over money. We just don't. And I'm thankful for a wife, and I'm thankful for a mom who is a generous woman. A decision that we made to live generously because God is a generous God. And a part of our legacy is that our kids all see that God is as a generous God because we see God as a generous God. A great provider, it's one of his names. God who provides, who never fails. And even though there were times when we literally had nothing of means and we lived so far below the poverty line, you had to look up to see it. But they always saw, our kids always saw that God provided, and they never felt like they did without. It's learning, as the Bible talks about, being content with what we have. And to live below our means in order to give first to God and to save second and then live on the rest. It's managing resources when they come, no matter what the resources were, whether meager or whether an abundance. Small decisions then that made us able to be more generous than we could have ever imagined. And this is what I want to do. I want to invite you onto the same spiritual journey. And it's based on three verses that will change a person's life like it did for us in our marriage. Jesus said this, first of all, he said, "It is more blessed to give than to receive." Here's the second verse he said. He said, "Where your treasure is, there your heart will be also." He also said, "Store up treasures in heaven." So here's the amazing thing. You can set the course of your heart. You can aim your heart, meaning your center of the will, your emotions, your desires. You can set your heart and aim it where you want your life to go. And then the third verse is this. You cannot serve God and money. Those are the three verses. Now, here's the thing. As soon as you mention anything about generosity, whether it's in church or whether you're listening online at GB Christian, you think it's about money. And one of my goals has always been to break you of that. And only the Holy Spirit can do it. I can only just be his voice piece, his mouthpiece for his word, but the rest is up to you. It's amazing the love that God has for us. He's given us this free will. I've got to break you that. Here's why, because it's not about money. Because giving is the key that unlocks every door in your life. Every door. Which is why Jesus said and taught so much about it. Steve said last weekend, everything in your life is connected. It's so true. We have a tendency to compartmentalize. Well, I got this, I got my job over here, I got church over here. If you go to church, I got, you know, my kids over here, I got their activities, and you know, I got my money over here, got this money over. We come now to the true story of a mom in the Bible. And she, in her most desperate need, was presented a choice, just like you and just like me. One of the most profound true stories of faith and trust in the Bible. So in 1 Kings chapter 17, let me just kind of set the stage just a little bit here before we read from 1 Kings chapter 17. A guy by the name of Elijah all of a sudden shows up on the scene as we're about to read. Where did he come from? We don't know. He just showed up. But he was tasked by God to speak to the nation of Israel. Now, the nation of Israel was part of a divided nation. Israel had been divided just before this time in 1 Kings chapter 17. It had been divided into two nations, the northern kingdom, Israel, the southern kingdom, Judah. Two tribes of Judah in the southern kingdom, 10 tribes in the northern kingdom of Israel. But we read this. So Elijah is called to the northern kingdom, Israel. And Israel had turned their back on God. And they were facing the consequences. It happens that when a nation turns their back on God and pushes God out of everything, there's fruit to bear in that, negative fruit. So in 1 Kings chapter 17, verse 8 says this, then the word of the Lord came to Elijah. So here we go, about Elijah. So God speaks to him and says this, the Holy Spirit, get up and go to Zarephath of Sidon and stay there. Behold, I have commanded a widow there to provide for you. Here's the amazing thing about this. We don't even know her name. God does. And one day in Jesus, I'll get to meet her. So will you. Verse 10, so Elijah got up and went to Zarephath. When he arrived at the city gate, there was a widow gathering sticks. Now a city gate, when it says a city gate, don't think in terms of these doors that open. A city gate was actually a structure, a building, and it was designed typically and built into the walls that surrounded the city for defense purposes. And in order to get through the gate, it was a building, a structure. You actually had to enter into the front doors, and it was usually a path that went like this. And oftentimes up above, there were catwalks where people, in case they were attacked and people tried to get in through the city gate, they could attack them from up above, arrows, spears, rocks, hot water, whatever. So she's at the city gate. Elijah called to her and said, please bring me a little water in a cup so that I may drink. Now, God had already told Elijah that there'd be a widow there and that she would provide for him and help him. So he asked for a drink. As she was going to get it, he called to her and said, please bring me a piece of bread. Now, he didn't know the dire circumstances that her and her family was in. Elijah was being obedient to the Lord. But look what she does. But she replied, as surely as the Lord, your God. Now, I want you to notice something. It's not, she doesn't say our God. She says your God. I don't know your God. Your God lives. I have no bread. Only a handful of flour in a jar and a little oil in a jug. Look, I'm gathering a couple of sticks to take home and prepare this meager little meal for myself and my son, that we may eat it and die. She knows they're starving. And with that last little bit of flour in a jar, just a handful, and oil in a jar, that would be it. And then Elijah said to her, don't be afraid. Would you say that she had good reason to be fearful? Even if not for herself, for her boy? Elijah said to her, go and do as you have said. But first, make me a small cake of bread from what you have and bring it out to me. It's like, are you, what? It's amazing when it comes to resources and God providing how counterintuitive things can be. Afterward, make some for yourself and your son, for this is what the Lord, the God of Israel says. And then there's a promise. There's always a promise. God always has a promise. It's a promise from God. And now she will have a choice to make, just like every single one of us. She has a choice to make, either trust and obey or not. No middle of the road. It's either, you know, we can't obey 90%. It's either trust or not. The jar of flour will not be exhausted. Here's the promise. And the jug of oil will not run dry until the day the Lord sends rain upon the face of the earth. So, you know, what do you do with that? Most would say, you're crazy. Who is this guy, Elijah? You're nuts. I'm not going to do that. But look what happens. So she went and did according to the word of Elijah. She trusted that this guy had heard from God. And listen to this. And there was food every day for Elijah and the woman and her household every day. And then look at this. The jar was not exhausted. Was not exhausted. I love that. And the oil did not run dry according to the word the Lord had spoken through Elijah. What a promise. Do you think that she became a believer in the one true God? Absolutely. Her view of God instantly changed, just like that. Most people form a view of God based on the sum total of their life experiences. You do, I do. In this widow's case, life was just hard. She had experienced a loss in her life, a husband. And chances are that she saw God as being uncaring, just like people do today. If there is a God, I don't think he really cares, or all this stuff wouldn't be going on, or distant. Or maybe God is just a hard God. But she gave. She gave out of her need to help someone else. And it opened an incredible door, a door that she could not ever begin to imagine herself. That's what God does. And she saw God entirely differently from that point on. Most people see God in one of two camps, either a giver or a taker. And somewhere, people oftentimes will find themselves leaning towards one or the other. God's a taker or God's a giver. And they lean. And their response to God is dependent upon which way they lean. When we give, as we just see, I mean, there's so many lessons that just jump out of this. When we give out of our need to help others first, we place ourselves in the flow of how God has made life and intended for it to work. Instead of life against us, life can work for us when we step into the river of God's flow and his blessings. So it's what you plant in your life, what you sow. We reap a harvest of faithfulness of God. This mom learned, give something to God and then watch it multiply. Rather than giving up, rather than think give up or give over, she gave in and said, I'm going to be obedient. You know, in order to be a Jesus follower, you know what you said? You had to say this at some point. I give up. I've got this area in my life. Maybe I could give Jesus a chance. Maybe in a relationship. Maybe in my job, my marriage. I can't save myself. Life is too big. And you said, I can't. And then you made a decision to say this, God can. At some point, I can't forgive that person. But God says this, when you forgive, you give something, and it sets you free. Elijah had a word from God for this single mom. Don't fear. I want to take just a little sidebar here because there are some principles that we can discover from this widow. Here's the first one. Worry and fear of not having enough is a normal emotion that happens. It's what we do with that fear that makes a difference. So it's a normal emotion. Am I going to have enough? Can I pay the bills? Can I provide for my family? Can I take care of this? But here's the thing. But it assumes that I will, that fear, I'm not going to have enough, it assumes I'm going to face tomorrow's needs with today's resources. And that's a mistake we make. Only this much today, but look what's coming tomorrow. Or what about 3 months from now? Or what if this happens 6 months from now? Which is why Jesus spent so much time. He said this. He said, look, don't worry about your life, what you'll eat or drink, or about your body, what you wear. Is not life more than food and the body more than clothes? Matthew chapter 6. And Jesus said this. He said, look, give us this day our daily bread. How often? We trust in him day by day. Here's the second thing. Having trust and faith is always, always has been, and always will be, a choice. It's a choice. She had this incredible faith placed there by God, and it was activated when she planted a seed of faith, incredible faith to give first before meeting her own desperate needs. It's amazing. And that's, you know, to do that, it's no guarantee of a windfall, but always a promise that God will provide when a choice is made to put God first. She was being obedient to God because she knew that it was a word from the Lord. The first fruits, the Bible calls it. We give it to him first. The Bible says this. The Bible says that God is love. And the one defining quality of love, what is it? The one quality, defining quality of love, and the way that you see love is give. So who's God? Love. And the defining quality is that God is giving. That's who God is, a generous God. So there are three types of us who fear and worry. Here's first type, because all of us will fit into one of these three categories at one time or another. Here's first thing. Number one, all of us. All of us at one time or another fear and worry over things. Now, you've heard me say this if you've been here or listened online for any length of time, that you're looking at a recovering worrier. And if there was not anything to worry about, I'd worry, because there's got to be something to worry about. And I knew, this goes way back to my early 20s, I knew that the next letter in the mail was going to be a bill that would take us under, or a knock under the hood meant the whole engine was going, you know, I would just worry. A definition of worry is this: it literally is a tearing apart, to treat roughly, a continual biting. Now, there's a healthy fear and there's an unhealthy fear. Let's take a look at both. Because Jesus is not forbidding normal emotions. When Jesus said, don't worry, he's not forbidding normal emotions. Why? Because the Bible says that we're to prepare for a potential crisis. That's just common sense. Look at this verse, Proverbs 27, verse 12. It says this: a prudent person foresees danger and takes precautions. The simpleton goes blindly on and suffers the consequences. So we're to have a problem. That's why saving, give, save, and live. That's why I love the 10-80 rule. 10% to the Lord, 10% saving, 80% we learn to live on. Next, Jesus doesn't forbid concern for managing what you have. I love this verse. Proverbs 27 says this: know the state of your flocks and put your heart into caring for your herds. I love that. So did you check your flocks this morning? Whatever it is, take care of your flocks and they'll take care of you. That's what this verse is saying. Take care of your car and it will take care of you, car that God gave to you. And you manage it, you take care of it. Same thing with a home. But Jesus does, here's the difference, does have a problem with those who turn everything into a what if, like I used to do. What if this happens? Somebody has to worry around this place. What if? And people who are that way, you know what they do? They negatively exaggerate and magnify and catastrophize everything. It's the worst. The sky is falling. Or Jesus has a big problem with spreading fear and worry. That's what worriers do, and fearful people. They spread worry and fear to everyone around them, their family, their kids, their spouse, their coworkers. And here's the amazing thing. Maybe you've noticed this, that fear and worry spread faster than faith and trust. You ever notice that? Some remarkable true stories about the spies who went into the promised land and came back. 10 spread fear and worry. 2 said, "We can't. God can." Number 2. The second type of person are those who choose to never change. And what a shame. God says, "I love you enough to give you a choice." And that really speaks for itself. And the Bible's full of people that refused to change from the inside out. The help was there. The power was there to do so. God's wisdom, his manual for living, and the Bible was there for them. But they refused to really change. Number 3, third type of person. Some who will change by being obedient to the word and listen to the Holy Spirit. So we just went through that series of listening to the Holy Spirit, never leaving you, forsake you, living on the inside of you. You can even be baptized, immersed, filled with the Holy Spirit. And that's always the most amazing thing about God's love. In his love, God says this, you choose to obey and listen. He loves us so much to do that. So there are just simply 2 choices: to believe that God is good and will provide if I trust and live in humble dependence upon God. It's just this humble dependence. Okay, God, give us this day our daily bread. Or 2, I don't believe God is good and will not provide, and I will not live in humble dependence upon God. I barely have enough for me and mine, and I want more. That's why the Bible says whoever loves money never has money enough. The widow, she made a choice to believe that God is good and that God would provide. And boy, did he, so abundantly. How can you imagine that? You know, these magical flower containers and oil that just keeps pouring out. I mean, it's just amazing. She didn't know how God was going to do to supply. She didn't even know that was going to happen, but she trusted that God is good. And when we give out of our need to help others first, let me say it again, we place ourselves in the flow of how God intended life to work for us. Give God something and then watch it multiply. So Jesus said this. He said, "Give and you will receive. And your gift will return to you." And it may not be in resources, but it'll return to you in so many ways: freedom and joy and power. And Jesus said this, when you do that, he said, it'll return to you pressed down, shaken together. It's shaken together down to make room for more, running over and poured into your lap. And the amount, I'm not talking about just money, the amount you give will determine the amount that you give back, the amount that you get back, rather. Now, some of you are so far in debt, and I don't have anybody in mind, but our culture somehow demands that we have to maintain a certain level of a lifestyle. We've got this bill and that bill, and my kid has this, and my spouse needs this. You know, the list just goes on and on, doesn't it? But for some of you, you're so far in debt that you can't give. Well, start with something. And as the Bible says, do it regularly. Maybe it's just 0.5%. Maybe it's 1%. maybe 5%, maybe more. Give something so that God has something to work with. God can't bless if we have his hands tied behind his back. God says, I want to bless. Give me something to work with, to multiply back to you. God is more generous than you or I could ever imagine. And because God is a generous God, these principles are built into this universe, and especially this world that God created for us. I am so thankful that all those years ago, Meg and I made a decision based on the verses that I've read to you and shared with you to say we will trust and we will obey. And it's been amazing. You see, here's the thing. For those of you that are familiar here with all, look what all that God has done. It would not have been possible without us learning that God is our provider and being generous with what he's given. And then you know what God did? He blessed his church and you, a generous people. We're around the world. We support missionaries in dozens of different countries. We support Convoy of Hope when there's a disaster, human trafficking, the list goes. You can't outgive God. And the more that we give to help others in a time of need, the more God just blesses so that we can give back. It's a river. It flows, it flows, it flows. And I feel sorry for people who get an amount and they sit on it. In case of a rainy day, well, for some people, it's like they're preparing for a flood, not a rainy day. And they're missing out on the multiplication that could be theirs of blessings in ways they cannot imagine. The choice for every single one of us is to choose where to aim your heart. Where your treasure is, there your heart will be also. And it's not hard to figure that out, is it? It really isn't. You just take a look at a person's ledger. You can do that. Hey, here's my heart. It goes to this and this and this. But there was nothing left for God, our generous God who supplies. For some of you, it will be the hardest step of faith that you've ever taken, even if it's just a small amount to set aside for God. But I know that my God will prove himself. It's the only place God says, test me and watch and see if I don't open the windows of heaven and bless you far beyond your wildest imagination. Would you pray with me? Our gracious Heavenly Father, you're a generous Heavenly Father, so generous that you loved. You loved me. You love every person listening or tuning in. You love this world so much that you led the way. You gave your only begotten Son. And whoever believes will never perish. Whoever believes in him will never perish, Jesus, but have eternal life. Thank you. Would you pray this prayer with me? Jesus, thank you that you loved me so much you gave your life. How can I not give back to you? And then to open the windows of your blessing in my life. I don't want to live just for me. I want to live for something bigger than me, to make a difference, not only in my community and my family, but around the world. And so Jesus, I will lean on you and your Holy Spirit to speak to me. I want to trust. I want to obey, even in a desperate time. Thank you, Jesus, for what you've given to me, eternal life. I want to store up treasures in heaven, and I want to start now. Lead me, guide me, and I accept you as my Savior and my Lord, and I'll trust you, and I'll obey you. In your name, I pray. Amen. Did you pray that prayer and mean it? And the bottom of the screen is gvchristian.com. We want to help you get started. If you need a Bible, we'll get you a Bible. If you have some questions, please email us. Let us know at that website, gvchristian.com. We'll answer your questions. We want to help you on the greatest journey that you can ever know. Father, would you bless your people? You do so time and time again. Would you lift up the light of your countenance and be gracious to us? We thank you and praise you for your peace. Peace in every area. In the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. God bless you. I love you. We'll see you next weekend.